Having a great night. Last night was a powerful kickoff.
Yes.
Amen. And we're just building on it.
Amen.
Amen. Before we get started, we'll have a meal after service. Right, boss lady? She's saying, yeah, while she's eating. That's my girl. And just some of y'all had, I'm just gonna pull this out. Some of y'all had expressed, you know, you want to go down and see Paula's shop and everything. And so afterwards, if you want to follow us down there, you can do your thing. It's a woman's paradise. Oh yeah, yeah. Darren said that you may want to silence your phone. Amen. He's our everlasting Father. Worship the Lord with me. Mighty God, Prince of Peace, the Counselor of all men, at His bringing great relief. This corporate man arising.
We're going to sing Fairer Than the Lily of the Valley. If you can find it in the book, if you have some copies out on the chair.
Yeah, we've got copies, and we don't know the words.
Thank you. can do or ever will do, hallelujah, that will cause you to be a disappointment in the eyes of the Father. You're a mighty man of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He has a great, great, great destiny in mind for you. Hallelujah. Last night, you know, you get a hold of things and you want to save them to the right time. When Dennis was ministering, I begin to hear this in my spirit, and I feel it particularly for you. We cannot sustain His Word. And that's what religion does. It teaches us that we must sustain His Word. In other words, carry it, walk with it. You know, and it becomes a forced thing. And the Word, you don't sustain His Word, Joseph. His Word sustains you. It holds you. It keeps you. It guides you. Stop trying to measure up to religion's idea of what it means to be a Christian. Hallelujah, because we are more than just Christians, Joseph. Hallelujah, you are a mighty man of valor. Hallelujah, more than conquerors. The Word sustains us. It'll cause you to be suspended in the heavenlies. Religion wants you to measure up, and it'll deplete you. It'll tax you completely out. And I'm being nice. Maybe I shouldn't be nice. It'll wear you the hell out. Won't it, Russ? So let us take advantage of this opportunity. This isn't a one-man show. We need to lift these men and women of God who put this thing together. Yes. And I'm the least among them. Hold their arms up. Strengthen them. Yes. And let God minister to us, through us. Not through one man or this one or that one. That's why I'm in worship, just beginning to minister one to another. When you're in Him and He's in you, you can't be out of order. And what we call order is really disorder and discord. Because religion has turned this thing upside down. Healing we... Russ, come here. While you're right here. Thank you. us. I didn't have an opportunity. He began to minister to me. And that's what it's about.
Yes.
Ministering one to another.
Yes.
Thank you, Grace.
Thank you.
Saying over and over was a proceeding word. Yes. I think I got that right. And we need to understand that God is moving a people. It's transition time. We're moving in the Spirit. In days gone by, let me put it this way, in days gone by, every time God would have a move in the earth, okay, you can go to Pentecost, you can go to Charismatic, you can go to Latter Rain, whatever. They always put a name on it. And they tried to organize it. They tried to get it something so we can control it. But God says, I've got a way that the vulture's eye has not seen.
Amen.
And I believe we're headed in that direction even now. One of the things that the Lord quickened me about if I can share this just for real briefly this morning. The Bible said that Abraham received a word from the Lord. And Abraham received a word from the Lord. Take your only son, the son that I promised you. And see, we think when we hear something from the Lord, it's an end-all thing, and it isn't. It's a progressive thing.
Right.
So take your son, your only son, take him to Mount Moriah, which is type and shadow and appearing, sacrifice him there to me. The Bible said that he took his son, a servant, and they took the fire, and they went to the mountain. That was the first day. How many knows that Abraham believed that was the word of the Lord? He believed it so much, he took the sacrificial dagger, and he took his son, which a lot of people think he was just a kid, but by all accounts, he was around 25 or so years old. And you take him and sacrifice him on the mountain. He believed it, and it absolutely was true, the word of the Lord. Amen. But the Bible said, after 3 days, it's a new day. They came to the place where God had intended. And Dennis said something last night I thought was many things, but the one thing that stuck in my spirit was so powerful is we need to understand that when God speaks to us anything, a promise, a prophecy, a dream, a vision, however he chooses to unveil himself to you, he may or may not speak anything beyond that for a long time. I mean, I think of so many times of how God spoke to Isaiah and said, I'm going to give you a sign. The virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, thou shalt call his name Emmanuel, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It was over 700 years later before that came to pass.
There it is.
We get upset if God don't move by Friday.
Amen.
And here's Abraham. He goes up. He's got his son stretched out on the altar. He's got his dagger. He's got fire. He's got everything ready to obey God based on the word that he's been walking in for 3 days. And it's necessary we understand that if we don't hear a proceeding, fresh, daily, unveiling current, I mean now, today, we're going to kill our promise.
Amen.
We're going to operate in yesterday's word, which was the word.
Right.
But it's not the word for today.
Right.
There's a fresh word.
Yes.
So if you operate in yesterday's promise, yesterday's revelation, yesterday's word, whatever you want to call it, it's a good thing until God brings you to a new day. But that word has death in it.
Yes.
And the Bible said that here goes Abraham. He goes up there, and he's ready to obey God, operate. And can I tell you something? It's a good thing it wasn't us on the mountain. Because as we're getting ready to plunge the dagger into the heart of our promise, God says, Abraham, Abraham, don't do it. We're going. That can't be God. That can't be God. Because God said, I've even got the tape. I was at the service. I got the tape. I know exactly what God said. He said, kill him. I got to do it. I'm sorry.
Amen.
And this is what we've done all this time. We get up in these meetings, and not even in these meetings, but in our daily lives, we get up operating on yesterday's word.
Amen.
Not realizing God has brought us to a new day, and he's got a new word for us, a proceeding word. My mind began to go to there in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Dennis called it the last night's Christmas story, so that's what we know it as. When the Bible said that the angel came to Mary and said, you found favor. And the Bible said she wondered about this strange salutation.
Yeah.
Anytime God tells you you found favor, look out.
All right.
Because that's what she goes, there's something going on here. And the Bible, and if you read that there in Luke, the second chapter, first and second chapter, you find out that there was some, when the wise men came and brought their gifts and things of that nature, and all this stuff was going on,
The Bible said that Mary pondered them in her heart.
Amen.
And what that literally means is she began to weigh everything out. And don't we do that?
Right.
Every time God speaks, I wonder if it's God.
Yes.
Some of y'all wonder if it's God coming here.
Now you really wonder.
But God has brought us to this day. And please understand, here we are in this day, and God says, I've got a fresh new word of bringing you to a direction you've never been before. And we're going, I don't know if this is God or not. Because it doesn't measure up to where I've been. Doesn't measure up to what we've been dealing with. I don't know if this, and the Bible, that's really what it is. The Bible said Mary was arguing in her own mind about whether or not this was God. This is where we are now, because what God is speaking in this hour is such a fresh proceeding word. And what do? We ponder like Mary. We run back, grab our King James, and try to figure out if it's really God.
Amen.
And King James don't know.
I'm losing friends today.
But God says, I've got a fresh word you've never seen or heard before. There is forerunners in the house today that God says that all of this confusion, all this stuff, I'm about to blow upon the storm of your life, and there's going to be a change of direction when you walk out of this place like you've never seen before. Even this morning, I began to get up early, and God began to drop some things in my spirit. And I want you to know, ladies and gentlemen, you're not here by accident. God brought you here, and you might think you're here for one reason, but I'm here to tell you God's got something fresh, new, and different that He's going to do in some lives. Why? Why is He doing this? Because there's a groaning creation out there that desperately needs to be set free. Religion ain't setting free. The denominations are not setting free. There's nothing. I'm going to say this. Kingdom ain't even setting them free.
Come on.
That's just a little different order of where we've been.
Right.
But God says, I've got a fresh word that I'm flowing into you that's going to break your shackles, break your thoughts, break everything about you. Amen. That's why we've been ministering to this thing called the heavens on fire. Because He said, I'm changing everything you've ever known about me. You got to understand that about that. And I really appreciate what Dennis said last night about after he come out of that 10-year thing there. That, you know, he really thought he had done something. And instead, God said, you're still just a knucklehead.
Yeah.
And I have to say amen.
Amen.
But here we find, God says, get ready. What I'm doing is I'm bringing you into some places. You're not going to find any familiar landmarks where I'm bringing you.
Yeah.
Oh, my. I'm about to bring you into some things you've not understood. Don't make me say this. You're going to start loving people you don't want to love.
Come on.
You're going to start having mercy on people you don't want to have mercy. You're going to start doing things you don't want to do. Because God said, I'm putting my nature in you, and man has not seen. Isn't that what He said? I have not seen, you have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God had prepared. But the Apostle Paul, which in my opinion was ahead of the other disciples, and he said, but God hath revealed it unto us.
Yes.
He said, I'm one born out of new season. I was not allowed to come to full term. Oh my. I'm here to tell you that God's got some ones in the house today that are coming to full term. I'm here to tell you we're about to be birthed. Why? Because the Bible said when the fullness of the time came, God said, for the Son made of a woman made under the law to redeem them that could not redeem themselves. God says, I'm putting you, and please understand, this is not a church building message. We're not here to gather people under ourselves. I'm here to tell you that when you leave here, we're going to be like the disciples dispersed to all the earth. And God says, I'm putting a word of life in you, not a word of denomination, not a word of religion, but a word of life that's going to get down into your spirit and change you from the inside out. Please understand something. I'm not... This is my opinion. Do what you want to with it. I hope it's making sense to you. But what I'm hearing is this. The Lord said, the word that I'm giving you is not something. I think Dennis said this last night. I hope I've got this right. Amen. But what I'm hearing the Lord say, we hear, say, feel, and know things in our spirit. And when we try to verbalize it, we bring it down.
Every time.
I know there's times that God puts something in my spirit and I'll get up here and I'll start talking. I'm thinking, that ain't it.
Right.
That's not it.
Right.
It's more than that.
More.
Yes.
And I'm here to tell you that we're at a place now where God says, I'm going to cause you to speak a word. You might hear it with this thing on the side of your head, but it's going into your spirit, into your heart, and you cannot say, I agree or disagree, because it has nothing to do with what you, oh my God. Just like the Apostle Paul thought that he was doing the right thing by killing God's people.
Right.
He thought, and that hadn't been us. That's been us in days gone by.
Yeah.
We passed judgment on people.
Yeah.
We put them in chains and bondages in our heart, in our mind, with everything we thought and said. We've done things thinking we're doing God a favor. But God says, like the Apostle Paul, amen, he's on the road to do more of God's will, just like us. We're always on the road to do God's will. Amen. The Bible said that he got smacked down in the middle of his journey, and God began to reveal him. And please understand something. If you read that story there in the book of Acts, the Bible says whenever he fell, the Apostle Paul didn't say, gee, what's going on? What's happening? Who is this? He knew who it was. Can I tell you something? God knows how to speak the language of every man, woman, boy, and girl on this planet. Oh, hallelujah. When I say speak the language, I'm not talking Spanish, Chinese, or whatever. I'm not talking that stuff. I'm talking about he knows how to get right down into your innermost being. And he'll communicate with you something. And this is what God's getting ready to do with the people in this day and hour. Amen. There's a fresh word of life. Amen. That's here. That's going to flow into some lives of the people. You mark this down. Amen. So you're going to be walking around. All of a sudden a light bulb's going to hit you. And you're going to go, whoa, where did that come from? Something somebody put in your spirit last week, last month, last year. Something. Oh, is this making any sense? Amen. It's coming out. And God's beginning to say, look, this is what this is about. God says, I'm working a work in you and I'm changing you whether you like it or not. This is not something you can pray about. This is not something you hope for. You're not going to study it up. Amen. Your heavens literally are on fire. About the time I learned something a long time ago, Dennis. People ask me all the time, what do you believe? What's your theology? What do you believe? And I look up, I don't have a clue.
Right.
I don't know. But about the time I got it figured out, God moves on.
Yeah.
Oh, see, this is all about us following him, getting back in him.
Amen.
God changing things. God, I heard in creation. It's not about us being all holy and righteous in our own understanding and our own thoughts. God says, I'm doing something fresh and new in the midst of a people that are hungry for me.
Yes.
Amen. Now, please understand, who are these people? The Bible says, every man in his own time and in his own order. I'm doing something fresh and new. Amen. And if you're hearing something today, if you're feeling something, a witness inside of you, know this. God's put his finger on you from the foundation of the world. You didn't have any say-so in the matter. You had no vote in this thing. God's doing this thing. Isn't that what he said? God said, because I could swear by no other, I swore by myself. Oh, hallelujah. Folks, let me tell you something. God's in control of this thing.
Come on.
Oh, hallelujah. When we start going about our daily lives, amen, we're trying to follow God on yesterday's promise, yesterday's word, yesterday's prophecy, yesterday's everything, and we wonder why God's not bringing to pass whatever it is we think ought to be brought to pass.
Amen.
And I know y'all don't think this way, but I do. When I hear the Lord say, yea and amen, this, thus saith the Lord, da, 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 immediately I know what he's talking about. I know y'all don't do that. And there's nobody on the planet more surprised when he don't do it. I see some heads nodding. So we got to figure it out, because we're holy. We're chosen. We're priests of the Lord. Yeah, we're big shots in the kingdom. God knows this stuff. We're just way up in the echelons. And we don't have a clue. Truth of the matter is, God said before, don't make me say this. I used to hang out with some people years and years ago, and Bob may know some of them too. Amen. Well, I was back there in the beginning with God, and we talked, and we decided. God asked me if I wanted to come to earth, and I said, sure. I thought, what a moron. I like what God told Job. Where were you?
Yes.
Where were you?
Yes.
And see, this is where God's doing something fresh. We need to understand. God has chosen those of you that are listening to me now. You're bearing this witness. He chose you in Himself before the foundation of your world. You had no say in the matter. He's brought you here of His own divine purpose and destiny. The fact that you've not seen that destiny yet does not mean God has delayed. I appreciate that word last night, Dennis. So many of us, we know, we bore witness that God put His hand on us back whenever. We know this. We feel this. We understand this. And so we wonder, and I look at some of these things, and I got to say this. As we begin our journey, and I look around the room, I know some of you are going to know what I'm talking about. You begin your journey, and somewhere along this journey, you've not seen the fruitfulness of that work.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
And you think, well, maybe I misinterpreted it. Maybe I missed the Lord. Maybe I don't know. And so we're like Isaiah. And we're like Daniel. And we're like all these different ones of the Scriptures. How do we wonder? God said, and we know God said, but ain't nothing happening. And we don't know what's going on. We sit here today, and some of us have been in this quite a while, and we look at it and we say, well, we've heard this word, we've heard this, and don't seem to be no changes. And now when somebody gets up and says, God's doing this and this and this, we're going, yeah, well, it's kind of hard to get excited. Because we don't see anything. But I'm here to tell you, it's going to be like the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. God's about to wake us up one day, and we're going to have a whole new mindset.
Amen.
That's where this fullness is on us.
Yes.
Amen. See, you understand me? This thing is on us.
Yes. Amen.
We get bogged down, and I know we do. We all do. We get bogged down. We're wrestling with our age, and we're wrestling with our health, and wrestling with our kids, and our health, our finances, and God knows what else. We wrestle with all these things. And we do our best to hang on to whatever it is that God said when. But I'm here to tell you, just because we don't see the fruitfulness of the thing as the sun goes down every day, doesn't mean God's not at work.
Come on.
Amen.
And He's working and He's moving. It's our job. It's our job to understand that God is faithful.
Amen.
God is faithful. And if He said it, He'll do it. He may not do it in your time frame. He may not do it with your understanding. He may not do it with your approval. But He'll do it.
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yeah.
I feel like God has brought this bunch of people together on this wonderful weekend, and those that might be watching on Facebook, He's brought us together to understand something. And I looked around the room today as we were worshiping the Lord, and I thought, my God, there's some heavy loads in the house. There's some people need some serious moves of God for them. And I'm believing God to do just that.
Amen.
You may not fly out of here like Superman, and that's okay too. But just know this, God is faithful.
Yes.
Amen. The Bible said that, and it reminds me of this. It reminds me of when old Joseph was about 17 years old, and he had that dream. Remember that? He had the dream about his brothers bowing down to him. He goes out there, and he tells his brothers, they didn't want to hear his revelation. They put him in the pit, stripped him.
Right.
Here's the thing about it. Joseph had the dream when he was 17. The Bible does not record anywhere in history or the Bible in any version that God ever said anything else to him at all.
Exactly.
Right.
It's 20 some odd years later, 22 years later. He's 39 years old. He's forgot about the dream. How do you know the Bible says so?
Yes. It does.
Some of us, God's promised you your kids. Or God's promised you your health. Or God's promised you whatever. And we say, well, and I think Dennis said last night, how that we think, well, okay, God hadn't moved between now and last week, so I need to find me a good sermon to go to.
Yeah.
I need to get me a tape. I need to get a CD or a book. I need to get a word. Because maybe, just maybe, God changed His mind. And so we run around here wondering about all this stuff. It reminds me of Joseph. He goes out there, guys, God, and he knew it was God. God gave him this dream. ABC 1, 2, 3. They didn't like it. They put him in there. Ended up his entire adult life a prisoner.
Amen.
He shows up. We know the story. He's now second in the command of Pharaoh. 7 years of plenty, 2 years into the famine. His brothers finally come along. At this point in time, because of everything he'd been through, God had to change Joseph.
Amen.
Can you understand me?
Yes.
Before his brothers could be ministered to, God had to change Joseph.
Amen.
This is where we are. We don't understand. We want God to move and do what he said 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago, and it doesn't seem like anything's changed, and we're just rocking right along, and we think, well, I, it's been a while. I better go get a new word.
Yeah,
I need somebody to prophesy me something here so I can hang on. And God says, I'm faithful.
Amen.
Amen. Here's the thing. All right, here it is. The Bible says, Jesus told his disciples. How many know Jesus constantly, like the Father, created?
Yes.
With me?
Yes.
You know, when Jesus talks, who he is the creator. For in the beginning was the Word, the Word was God, and the Word was God. There's nothing that was created except was created by Him, for Him, and through Him. Amen.
When He speaks, He's not shooting the breeze.
Right. Come on.
Yes.
We look at each other, and we always run our mouth about something silly.
Yeah.
And somebody says something about it, well, I didn't mean it. Amen.
Yeah.
But when Jesus talks, He's talking. There's something going to happen. Something will change.
Yes.
Okay, watch this. Disciples, let's get in the boat.
Yeah.
And let's go to the other side.
Yeah.
No doubt they thought it was a suggestion.
Yeah.
Like us.
Amen.
Most of the time when God talks to us, we think it's a suggestion.
Yeah.
What are we doing back here?
Between
him and Russ, they're always doing something.
Don't pay me no mind. Stay in the spirit.
He's lengthening my leash.
That's all we got.
That's warning of Lord of mercy. Now watch this. This is us. The Lord says, Paulette, get ready. I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to add to you. I'm going to bless you. You're not going to spend your days alone. Immediately, now she don't do this, I'm pretty sure. We mark the calendar. Oh, nobody wants to help me today. Eleanor, something's fixing to change for you, honey. And y'all think I'm just shooting the breeze up here preaching. I'm telling you the word of the Lord. Something's fixing to change for you.
Amen. Come on.
God's about to do something beyond your wildest imaginations. And I don't know how to say this any other way, but what I'm seeing in the spirit, don't you put your roots down too much there. And she just got there. Okay. And so when God tells us these things, we're like the disciples. We get in the boat. And we're going to the other side.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. We're following God in His grace. I'm doing what He said to do. I'm following the Lord. It's just wonderful. Oh my God, what's this storm coming? Jesus, you didn't say nothing about no storm.
That's right.
That rasta brain. See, when I got the word, the boat was really sitting there pretty and nice, and it was sunny and nice, and the Lord just blessed me, John and Cindy, He just blessed you, and oh, isn't God good? God's just so good. Yeah, that charismatic refrigerator magnet thing. God is good all the time. You won't find that refrigerator magnet in my house. Not right, baby. Because God ain't good all the time. Not as far as I'm concerned. He is God all the time. That's all I can say. So we're in the boat because God said. We're headed out because God said. But He didn't say nothing about no storm. So where are you at, God? What's going on?
Does this make any sense?
Yes.
Yes.
So here we are. We're rocking right along. And we're headed out because God said, hallelujah, the best days. Ooh, you hear that? I'm playing this tape all day. I like this. You ever notice that? When God gives you good work, you get the tape or CD and you play it all the time, but if it's a bad work, boy, you miss that. Come on now. I know I don't want to do that. I know more false prophets than I do anything. So here we are. We're rocking right along. This is where we are. We received a word from the Lord. And if God don't hurry up and do what he says, and it turns out the way I think it ought to turn out, and it's all sunshine and roses and smiley face, then somebody missed God. So what do? We do like the disciples. When the storms come, we start looking for Jesus. Come on. Somebody says, ooh, boy, there's a good meeting going over here. We want to get a word from God. And then we may or may not get it, so we go to the next meeting. And we don't understand that while we're in our boat and we're headed onto the other side, we don't understand we're not floating on the water, we're floating on the Word.
Amen.
The Bible said Jesus, when they found him, he was asleep in the boat. What? Lord, don't you even care that we perish? I know you said to get in the boat, and I'm doing what you said, and now you don't even care. This is where we are. This is where we are. Some of you, you better hear me now. This is where you are. You've been walking in a whole new direction of your life. Russ, Sabrina, been walking in a whole new direction of your life.
Amen.
And the storm's coming. And we can't find him on the tape or CD. We can't find him in a dream or a vision. We can't even find him doing the old tried and true method of opening your Bible and I know y'all don't do that. Am I telling anybody the truth in the house?
Amen.
Yes. Wake up. We need to hear a word from the Lord. I don't have a word from the Lord. Okay, where's my Bible? If we determine, and we don't realize he's there all the time.
Yes.
He is so confident that creative word is going to bring you to your destiny.
Amen.
He's resting in it.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We need to mature in God to the point that I may not see it right now. I may not feel it. It may look directly. Oh my God. Just as fun. Can I tell you, we're just like Mary. The angel comes and said, thou hast found favor, for you're going to bring forth the Son that calls his name Jesus, and he's going to save his people from their sins. And the Bible said, and Mary said, how shall this thing be, seeing I know not a man?
Amen.
There ain't no way. That's what we do. God speaks, and when we get in the boat, we're ready to go to the other side. The problem is, now that the storm's here, we're not going to make it. How are we going to make it, seeing we know not a man?
Amen.
How are we going to make it, since we can't figure out how God's going to do it?
Right.
And we don't realize God's trying to move you out of that religious, crazy mentality into the realm where he lives. Oh, hallelujah. For with God, nothing is impossible. Just look at it now and say, you know what? I can't figure it out. I don't know. I just know he said, get in the boat.
Yes.
But the waves are coming over the boat. We're soaking wet. We don't look like no conquerors. We're drenched. The winds are howling. We can't hear a word from the Lord because the winds are howling. The storm is brewing and that little old boat is tossed to and fro to the point nobody wants to ride with us. It's okay.
Yes.
Amen.
And we don't realize he's at rest in your boat. He's at rest. You will, hear me, you will come to your destination, place of God. It's not up to you.
No.
If it'd been up to us, by the time the storm hit, we said, well, maybe we jumped the gun. Maybe we moved out of time, Sabrina. Come on, guys. Maybe, just maybe. See, we got that, I don't care what we think, we still got that crazy Pentecostal mentality.
Come on.
Like God says, okay, you're going to ABC, 1, 2, 3, this is what you're going to do, and we got it all figured out. Like, oh, okay, God can only control so much of what I'm doing. Don't make me preach about your free will. I won't make no friends if I go down that road. See, we think you got a free will. Yes, God won't. I used to hear this all the time growing up. God won't override my free will. What a moron. Yeah, thank you, idiot. See, we don't understand. We don't understand. God's been God a really long time. And he is God so much that he'll make you think it's your idea to do what he wants. Oh, I just obey the Lord. You think?
Yeah.
I obeyed the Lord. See, the Bible said no man comes to Father except the Spirit draw him.
Yes.
Amen. You can't even pretend to want to hear God without the Spirit drawing you.
Amen.
I just want to throw this out real quick. I'm going to try to bless you. I just want to throw this out real quick. You need to be encouraged in the Lord to know you're exactly on time, on purpose,
yes,
on point,
that's
with
right,
God.
Yes.
Amen.
See, God, and I feel to say this, you guys got to understand this God that we're dealing with. He's not that old religious Pentecostal, Baptist, Methodist, whatever God that he's going to dangle a carrot in front of you and when you miss, smack you in the head.
Right.
Yeah, I tricked you. See, there, you just thought you'd follow me. And that ain't where I want you to go. He's a loving God. And because of that, he knows your heart. He looks at your heart. And he knows you're desperately trying everything within your power to follow him. And I feel to say this for some that are here, and I don't know why, but I do feel to say this. It's like this. If you feel like you're wrestling against God, God knows it's because you can't see the way he sees. It's not because we're trying to be rebellious and honoring.
Right.
He just knows, like you're raising your kids. There's times your kids think you're just so wrong.
Right.
But because your mom or dad, you see things they don't see.
Right.
And you don't beat them up because they don't see what you see. You know in time they will mature.
Amen.
Well, guess what? God's maturing us.
Yes.
To where we see like God sees. We're thinking like God thinks. And that's why we need to understand. You might be standing here today, this weekend, just sitting here thinking, how in the world, where do I go from here? What do I need to do? Rest in him.
Amen.
Rest in him. The way will open up at the appointed time. And you'll walk through it. Because your heart is to follow God. God knows this. And then God's not hiding somewhere trying to trick you. We need to understand, folks, there is a maturing coming to the saints of God. There's a maturing here. There's a maturing.
Yes.
A change of attitude. Our heavens are literally on fire.
Right.
Oh, hallelujah. And as I look around the room, I'm excited because I see God changing our hearts, our minds, our understanding.
Yes.
We're going to a great place in God. We're going to a great place in God. Mm. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What a fresh word in the house this week. Hallelujah. A soothing word. Fresh word. Let me just say, say this to you. If you received a word in that first day, let it go. He's got a fresh word in the third day.
Yes.
And whatever God put in your spirit way back, rest in it.
Yes.
Rest in it.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. Rest in that word.
Amen.
But I don't see the fullness of it. Rest in it.
Amen.
The storms are blowing. Rest in it.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. The Bible, and I like what it said, closing that portion of Scripture out. The Bible said when they woke him up, and they said, Lord, don't you care that we perish? Boy, this ain't us. I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
I don't know. I know y'all don't say that stuff, but I mean God. See, me and God, we got this relationship. And I tell him what I think, and he don't care. He just does whatever because he's God. And we need to find out, we need to understand that when I look at God and I tell him stuff, he looks at me and he knows my heart.
Yes, sir.
And this is where we are today. We're headed into a place of God.
Yes, sir.
Changes.
Yeah.
Get my musicians up here real quick for me. While I, please. Oh, hallelujah. God's got some great things in store this weekend. And I don't know if this made any sense for helping anybody today or not. But I want you to know something. He's at peace. He is at peace in your situation, no matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter. If you've got smooth sailing, he's at peace. And the Bible said, closing this out, the Bible said that he got up, rebuked the waves and the wind. And the next part says, and immediately they were on the other side.
Yes.
I like that.
Yes.
Immediately they were on the other side. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, my. I want to sing this chorus. I know we sang it last night, but I want to sing it again. I know Darren likes to hop it up. He had compassion on me. He healed my eyes, and now I see. Washed my feet, and now I walk in his way. A new appearing is at hand.
Thank you.
was something you wanted to share. All right, Clay, come on, Gary.
I don't like getting up here. When we were doing praise and worship, and it goes along with what Gary and what Dennis, but like he said, if Dennis set the tone, it's like he blew the trumpet in Zion. You remember when they were camped out on the River Jordan?
Yes.
And the ones that got to that place, it was a new generation. Well, guess what? You're that new generation. You got nothing to do with your natural age. That's what God's got to do in this generation, this time. And there's officers up here that get things in order. Okay. They said they always came out to the tent. The father came out to the tent and heard the trumpet blast. What the Lord had just said, that the Lord was speaking. And that's what he did. He blew the horn last night.
Amen.
And all that's required of any of us is come out of that, out of this tent, come before the Lord, and look up from which cometh your faith.
Yes.
And that's all we got to do from here on out. Like Dennis said, you don't have to hear anything else this week except what God says. But if that's all you hear this week, then be ye in Christ. That's all we got to do. That's all that's done me every day. I live every day to be in Christ. And like I said, I quit living on yesterday's manna. I quit eating the bread with worms in it. Because we all been there, done that, you know. But I thank God for Dennis. I thank God for these officers that Joshua says got things in order. And say, all of Israel got to go cross.
Amen.
We're all Israel.
Amen.
And you're here for a reason. To serve God. Yes. And Him only.
Yes.
Him, the people did. You ever had someone strip you? I have. It hurts.
Amen.
But sometimes it's necessary. That word he gave was necessary, a truth to be reconciled with. And I'm not going to re-preach what Father gave me, but I'm going to go on with it. Remember how Joshua was stripped? And I was showing how that the clothing that they began putting back on him came out of Isaiah 61. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord is up and on me. I always thought when you put something upon something, you lay it there. But Father is teaching us this innate nature that becomes in us so intently, so real, so surreal, that we don't have to think anymore. We don't have to pray it up. We don't have to worry about it anymore. All we've got to do is show up, shut up, and let Father come up inside you. I can't express that enough. And rise upon you.
Amen.
Because he's going to give you the word in that hour because you have swords in your mouth.
Yes.
And I've got news for you. I'm going to reiterate you, my friend. You're not brought here on your own.
That's right. That's right.
I don't care how many misturns you made. You were purposed to be in this place, in this hour, in this time, by God's strategic plan.
Amen.
And in his strategicness, he called you, he chose you, he drug you through some mud. I told Ron the word religion in Hebrew means re again. Lijon means to bind. He drug you through that binding just like he did Joseph. I have felt, I told Ron, I shared my heart. It's scary when I share my heart, but I have felt like I've been in a prison for so long. A prison that I could not get out of. But I quit fighting.
Right.
And the prison changed. God's calling again. I quit fighting the prison. I quit fretting over what should be. I quit worrying about what the word was and what the prophecy was. And I quit fretting and I started growing up a little bit.
Amen.
I started realizing that religion cannot tell me who I am, though I allowed it to do that. And I thank every person in this building that has allowed me to grow up, because when I first joined myself with you in my head, I thought, you know, I got something. Oh, I got something. I'm ready. You don't like the boxer. You know, I'm silly. I'm animated. Anyway, I thought I had something. And the Lord said, no, no, you don't. And the Lord caused me to set aside. And when Dennis was, I'm using Dennis, when Dennis was speaking, or even Gary or anybody, I sit there and I'm like, okay, mind, don't you dare think. Don't think mind. Don't think mind. Because I want to hear what Father is saying to me. I don't want religion to dictate to me anymore what Father is telling me. I don't want my mind anymore to take Father's word and pollute it anymore. It is polluted enough.
Amen.
It's like that dirty plate, Bishop. I love that. Get that dirty plate out of the garbage and put something good on it. Don't do that. This is the plate. Don't put that good word on there anymore because it pollutes it.
Right.
Hallelujah. You know, they have that 3-second rule. You drop the Oreo on the floor and pick it up. 3 seconds, I can eat it. I don't want no more 3 seconds. Joshua, I want to share this if I pretty please have time. Joshua, Hoshua, he was the high priest of that hour. That's who you are.
Yes.
His name was Hoshua, or Joshua, the just one. Stay with me. And he was brought before the people, and the people stripped him. And then the Lord showed me that up and on us, we were going to have that spirit that comes up in us. And we're going to minister that creative word to those,
right,
to God's people.
That's,
and we're going,
right,
to speak in that hour. And we're going to show up. And we're being told day by day by day that we are the kings and the priests of the Lord. Right?
Yes.
Master Gary, go get me water, pretty please, with sugar on top. He's telling us, we're telling us, these ministers, no matter who you are telling us, we are the kings and the priests of the Lord, right?
Yeah.
Come on, we're the kings and the priests of the Lord, and we shout, and we proclaim it, and we get up and down, and we dance, and we get yippee-ki-yay, right? I hope I can say that like a millisecond, but I finally matured enough to know that when he put that robe on me and prophesied to me, I got scared to death and I wanted to crawl under the bench. I got news for you. I wanted to run from here. I wanted to run from it because I knew, bless you, thank you, I knew what that prophecy meant. It's not always glorious.
Right.
Because when God, if you're really walking in the orders of the Father, if you're really walking where you want Him to speak to you and show you His will, you're going to get a little scared.
Right.
Because fire's coming.
Right. Yes, ma'am.
The storm's coming.
Yes, ma'am.
And what is storm? S-T-O-R-M. It's a spiritual transfiguration or transformation, my apology. A spiritual transformation of righteous magnitude, because storms are registered in magnitude. It's a spiritual transformation. It is not a natural transformation. So what is this order that He's calling us to? I asked Father, I said, what is this order you're trying to put upon us? And I didn't tell Gary this, I get scared to say it, but long ago they told me, this man who hated me, I don't know why, I didn't do nothing to the poor soul. He prophesied to me, he said, you're no longer a McDaniel, you're no longer a Miller. He said, you will be a priest of the Most High God. Well, I got my religious garments on me, and I thought, out for good, you know, I'm going to get up here, and I'm going to travel, and I'm going to do all that thing, you know. I put my religious garments on. And God said, no, no. And another 10 or 12 years, God set me aside. He said, I'm going to teach you some things. Let me tell you something. When the Father gives you an ordination, He's giving it to you because He's going to set you aside and teach you how to use it, because religion's going to do nothing but pollute it.
Right.
So God set me aside. I lost my job of 30 years, 31 years. My husband almost died with colon cancer, all in within a few months. And then that's nothing compared to 1987 when they took my son out of my arms and said he only had a 50% chance to live, and got out of the hospital 2 weeks later and had to move within 48 hours because I was losing my home. I mean, I've been there. I've been in the storm. So I asked Father, I said, what is this order that you're calling us to? What is this placing that we're supposed to be in? I don't want no more religious orders. I don't want no man to tell me what to do. I'm talking to Connie man, okay? I don't want Connie man to tell me how I'm supposed to live and be. And the Lord said to me, He said, I want you just to show up and be. I want you to be you. I want you to allow that word to come out of you. Even when you're sitting in Zaxby's, and the Lord just would not leave me alone, and that young man, probably thought I was a nut job. But I walked over there and I said, son, I've got a word for you from the Lord. And he said, okay. I mean, you don't know what these kind of people are going to do. You know, but I gave him a word and I said, now you have a nice day. And I left and never saw him again in my life. That's acting upon God.
Right.
I run into this lady at work. I was filled to share this. This lady at work, I didn't go over there and go, oh, no, 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 no. You know, get all crazy.
No.
All I did was bend down and give the word.
Yeah.
It's not necessary to do that. Those days are over.
That's right.
If you're going to walk in the high places of God, I can't express that enough. You are going to be you. I don't care if you're going to sit there and eat a piece of cake.
That's right.
And tell somebody life is going to be all right. You just hang on.
That's right.
That's what God wants His priests to do. So what is this order? This ordination. Order comes from the word, an English word, as a pattern. A pattern that is weaved like the tapestry. It comes like a ranking, because that's what the military based their military ordination and honors and all their branches on. There was an order.
That's right.
And it's a body of people, a body of ideas, a body or a group, use that word, group, of things operating under a discipline. And I said, oh. They're under a discipline. So there's got to be a discipline for the Spirit of the Lord to come up on me and set the creation free, right? To speak life to the body. There's an ordination to this. And I went, oh, religion missed it. And don't make you mad, but these sonship peoples missed it. You know, I thought I had to have a title. God took them all away. I ain't nobody. And I'm super happy. An order is an arrangement. It's putting things in for a purpose. The military, I'm going to use military. My husband was in the Navy and my father-in-law, the Air Force, and my other father-in-law, Coast Guard. So I've been around it a little bit. I don't know, probably like y'all, but I've been around it a teensy bit. My son-in-law is Army. He was some kind of sergeant person. He said he liked telling everybody what to do all the time. Anyway, it's an order. Well, I got news for you, priest of the Lord. There's an ordination out of this. It's not by name. It's not by your thinking. It's by Father speaking to you. And I don't have my Bible, but not always out of the Bible. I don't care what version you pick it up. God will kick you out of the bed and begin singing to you. I want to hear Father. I want to be that book that's added to the books. Before. This covering that Joshua was given. He said, I'm covering you. I'm arranging you. I'm adorning your spirit with the order or the ordination of Melchizedek. And I looked it up in Hebrew. We hear this a lot, but we don't know what it is. I looked it up in Malachi is king, and Melchizedek, he was righteous. This order that we're being brought into is not going to be something that you pick up and run with. You're going to be processed. I don't know if you heard that yet or not, but you're going to be processed. And when God gives you a word, whether it's Him speaking to you or through the ministry, or He kicks you out of bed like He did me, He gives you a word. He gave me a word the other day and said, abduction. I'm abducting you. I'm taking you out of the order you thought you were in, and I'm going to process you and put you in my order. Amen. Don't try to force it. Don't try to make it. Allow me to do it. Allow me to put an ordination upon you. From me. This ordination is lining things up and putting them in a discipline. And what was this discipline that he put on him? He said, I'm going to put this discipline on you that you have no heritage. Now, I think it's cute that people follow genealogies. If that's what you want to do and that trips your trigger, go for it. But that don't trip my trigger. I want my genealogy to be wrapped up in him. Because I'm weird. I'll tell you I'm weird. I saw by the eye of the Spirit the seed of God come out of himself and bring me forth. And ever since I was young, I've been the weirdo. And I'm okay with that. I like that. I'm different. And I know it. It took me a long time to deal with it. Because I battled with how different I was. I battled with it. But I'm not battling anymore. Now I'm resting. That word was with me a lot. I'm resting in the presence of Father within me.
Yes.
I'm resting in Him because there is no heritage. There's no earthly attachment to this. God spoke to me about a year ago. I have changed so much. God spoke to me about a year ago and He said, start devaluing those things that are destroying your life and destroying your thinking. Because the healing in any aspect, emotional, physical, whatever, it's in mind over matter. You got to be healed in your mind so that you can go through the things that we go through, right? Right, Bob? We got to have our mindset in the right place. We devalue those things. And I began doing that. I began devaluing everything that Father didn't want me to have. Even in my job. The Melchizedek order is the power of an endless life. It's the power to execute life to God's people. It's a king. A king is one that is a son because the son has the heritage of the father. So it's an authority to be the son of the living God. Jesus said, I and the Father, we are one. There was no separation. And that oneness is becoming more real to me. The more I think I'm separate from God, the less oneness I have. But the more one I think in the Father, the greater the oneness in me becomes.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
He was the King, the Son. He was the priest because he had the heart of the God, of God. And he was willing to be the servant not only to God, but to the people.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And he's the righteous one, just like the bride, the virgin. Do you see the commonality here? So he was the King, the Son. He was the priest, the servant. He's the righteous one, the pure virgin, the one that has a just life full of virtue. And he's also of peace and harmony.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but sometimes when I walk into a situation that's right chaotic, very chaotic, God, if there's no if. When it's chaotic and I arrive, I'm sorry, I'm not putting flowers on me by no means, but when I arrive, the chaos settles. And it ain't me. It's God. It's God. But now if my mind's not in the right place, buddy, I'll get in there and be part of the chaos. You've been part of the chaos? You haven't worked in an office? Golly, the gossip. Makes you want to. But we're not in that anymore. And in summary, I want to give this. We are ordained of God to be here, even those that may not even understand just yet.
Yeah, right.
Even though you may not comprehend it just yet.
Yeah.
You are the kings and the priests of the Most High God.
That's right.
You are set under the order and the ordination of Melchizedek that has no heritage, no lineage. You've come out of an eternal genealogy of God, not man. You can't be traced back.
That's right.
You have a power beyond this earthly existence, beyond any kind of fleshly miracles. Now, I believe in miracles. Don't go away from here and say, Connie, don't believe in miracles. I believe in miracles. But now it's a process. It has the authority of the King to judge and to command blessing.
Amen.
And be like God and come from the slaughter of the kings. Being subject to God because it has an order of compassion and mercy, just like the priest. Because to service God and his people. The King is in subjection to God just like the Son was. The priest, through the acting and the capacity of a servant, still had to follow the pattern, didn't he?
Yeah.
The order is an ordination of the bride.
Yes.
The one filled with jewels and adorned in beauty.
Yes.
In the purity of her heart and arrayed in white linen, no sweat of carnality. This order came and is a city and a body of peace, of calm delight. No longer reactive, but a body, not an individual, but an individual, purposed with a corporate plan to walk in this life. Because we are worshiping and walking God as the worship. We are worship. When you walk into the room, you become the worship. You become the praise. You become the life source that gives life to God's people. You want to wonder, if you want to know what God is calling you into, it's calling into a pressing, a processing, a pressure. You're going to be put in a pressure cooker. Get ready. And you know what? It's going to be all right. Because in this pressure cooker, God is going to make you unto his people. Because if you're really going to be unto God, you're going to be a servant of the Lord.
Amen.
You've got to be willing to serve his people.
Right. Right.
You've got to have the compassion on the ignorant and those that spit in your face and tell you they don't love you and you love them anyway.
Amen.
There's one who doesn't love me, but I love them anyway. I love them no matter what they've done to me. I have forgave them and moved on. I don't let it bother me when I'm in their presence, and I'm forced to be in their presence a lot. But I don't let it bother me because God has caused me to rise above it. You ain't better than nobody. If anything, I'm the grub worm and you are the body. And I pray to serve you and give you. I thank you for allowing me to grow up. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Bob, for being patient with me. If it weren't for Bob and Charlotte's songs, I don't know where I would be. I kept listening to them all through my journey through religion. But I kept going back to their songs. I really did. I'm telling you. This is an ordination of the Father. This ordination is special. You were not brought here by no means of your own. You were not brought here because Gary called and said, hey, we're going to have a meeting around here. That's not why you're here. You're here because God brought you here. And this ordination, he is going to process it through you. Don't go out of here and say, I'm a king and priest of the Lord. You better be careful.
Amen.
Ready back there?
Yeah.
Oh, she's coming up to give me my marching orders. Coming up here to give me my marching orders.
I just had to put it out. I just wanted to say one thing when we preached, and I told you the other night. I woke up and what time?
She preached all night.
I said, I preach. I don't preach. Oh no, I don't. But this goes right along. It was about delay.
Yes.
Had so many delay, and I was thinking of Bob a lot, and I was thinking of Cindy. That's what came to my mind. Delay, it doesn't change the purpose of God.
Amen.
And so you may have a delay, the surgery and all this. It's not going to change the purpose of God for you in your life.
Amen.
Cindy, going around, whatever, delay is not going to change his purpose. And that's what he was basically saying in God's word. All these, and if you look back in the Bible, nothing happened very quick.
Yeah.
It was delay, but it didn't change the purpose of God. So yeah, I just thought, woo! And Dennis, Dennis. And you had a 10-year delay.
Yeah.
And it didn't change the purpose of God.
Parents just block you in so you can't leave.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
I got
to go. It wasn't like she came in there that morning, Dennis, and she said, I've been preaching all night. She wouldn't tell me what. Not a word. Not a word. I'm shaking everybody's trees right now. We're going to dismiss now. If you will, get the guys to help on and move the tables out and put the chairs around it so everybody can eat. Amen. And after we eat, if anybody wants to go down to the shop and do your thing, God bless you. We'll be happy to do that. 6 o'clock tonight. I don't know.